Welcome back to America's Now. I'm Elaine Reyes. After more than a decade of prosperity and democratic stability, Peru is still wrestling with its recent past. In the 1980s and 1990s, an internal conflict raged between communist Shining Path guerrillas and the state. Add to that hyperinflation, misgovernment, and unprecedented corruption. They were difficult times in which to grow up. At the end of last year, a play called Proyecto 1980-2000 brought together four young people all affected by that period in wildly different ways. America's Now contributing correspondent Dan Collins went to find out how.
Last-minute rehearsals for a group of non-actors. A student, a documentary maker, a geneticist, and a wannabe rock star. They probably never thought they'd be stepping the boards together. But learning their lines may be just that bit easier, because Proyecto 1980-2000 is about them and the dramatic events that shaped their early lives.
Mi nombre es Carolina Ollague. Soy hermana de una de las víctimas del caso Cantuta. Es el caso de nueve estudiantes y un profesor que fueron secuestrados, torturados y ejecutados por un escuadrón de la muerte denominado el Destacamento Colina durante el régimen del ex dictador Alberto Fujimori en el 18 de julio de 1992. Yo tenía tan solo 12 años.
Sácame de aquí, por favor.
Letta, now a student, was a sheltered, sickly child whose father was a soldier.
Mi papá combatió el terrorismo. Y para nosotros, para mi familia, es, para mí es un héroe, ¿no? Yo sé que la otra mitad de la gente, como decía el chico, es un asesino. Yo me acuerdo que el chico me insultaba y me decía que los hijos de ese militar, diciendo el nombre de mi papá, eran unos malparidos, que no merecen vivir, que deberían sentirse avergonzados. Pero yo no entendía por qué. Yo sé que mi papá ha podido combatir el terrorismo, pero conmigo, con mi familia, era muy bueno. Era súper cariñoso. Nunca pensé que había matado a nadie.
Sebastian, a musician, remembers how his politician father was caught on video taking a large bribe in a scandal which eventually brought down the then government.
Well, in the year 2000, my father got taped. He appeared on a video. Receiving money from the assistant of the president and Vladimir Montesinos, and it meant 5.5 years of jail and a lot of problems in the family.
And Amanda, the investigative journalist's daughter, who only recently found out quite how dangerous life had been for her father and her family.
Actually, I now know I didn't really know nothing. My dad had another life, more secret even, that I can't talk, that I learned here. He was really more involved, even more than I can imagine. He has a lot of things I can say, not even in the play.
Together, their lives are the narrative thread for a roller coaster ride into the past, where the lines between the public and the private become ever more blurred.
This timeline unites the events of those two decades, bringing together the political above the red line and below it the personal for each one of the play's protagonists.
But this is their version of events, says Sebastian Rubio, one half of the creative duo who wrote and directed the play.
Trata de hacer una experiencia escénica acá de personas que hablen de la época de violencia política y corrupción, pero desde una generación posterior, no la historia contada por los protagonistas, sino por las personas de nuestra generación, porque para nosotros era importante cómo vivimos esa época nosotros, qué pasaba cuando éramos chicos, cómo los videos de las torres derrumbadas por los terroristas, o de los atentados, o de las masacres, o cosas tan cotidianas como el masking tape en las ventanas para que no se rompan con las bombas.
The terror, the danger, the grief, and even the black humor of those momentous times all unfold in this testimonial play, with the benefit of the 2020 vision of hindsight. For Carolina, the oldest of the group, It's a culmination of a painful but cathartic process of remembrance. In the performance, she tells how she was getting ready for a friend's 15th birthday party when she heard the news that her older sister had been murdered. It was the first of many happy childhood memories cut short by the dark hand of a criminal regime.
Una tarde de verano en la que yo salí a jugar con unas amigas mías, estábamos patinando y ya mi familia la seguía el servicio de inteligencia, ¿no? Tratando de amedrentarlos para que no pudiéramos hacer denuncias. Y miembros del servicio de inteligencia nos persiguen a mis amigas y a mí. Entonces, de ahí para adelante, yo ya ninguna de mis amigas puede volver a casa, ¿no? Y esas son las por qué no podíamos exponer sus vidas. Entonces, mi mamá le dice que dejen de venir, ¿no? Entonces, dejó de patinar también y no volvió a patinar.
More than a year after her disappearance, Carolina's older sister's body was identified using forensic evidence in a mass grave. It seems no coincidence that Carolina has built a career as a geneticist, specializing in DNA profiling, and dedicated her spare time to human rights activism. Acting, though, didn't come naturally, she admits.
Para mí en particular, o sea, significó un cambio de 180 grados, tal vez, ¿no? Porque yo siempre he tenido ese espíritu de científica, de ser una persona mucho más retraída, muy introvertida, y no me gusta mucho el público, no me gusta estar entre multitudes, ¿no? Y el que la violencia se atravesara en la vida de mi familia significó que me tuve que convertir en voz, ¿no? En la voz de aquella hermana que clamaba justicia.
In a similar way, for Amanda, it's about reconstructing memory and trying to understand the father she looked up to as a hero. But stirring up the past has made waves.
One really good friend of mine told me I was being unfaithful to my truth, because I was putting my life in fiction. I just start crying because I thought that was all about art. Art is doing that, right? And I felt that even people I love just don't want to see this. That's what happened to Peru. The Peruvians don't want to see the truth, don't want to see their own history. So when they see it, it's a way they look away, right? And they attack. And even people they love me, that love me, they attack me. It's weird. But also, there's a lot of people, wonderful people, that hold my hand and I'm able to stand up and say what I have to say.
Sebastian Curry was diagnosed with obsessive compulsive disorder the same year that his father was jailed more than a decade ago. They've had a difficult relationship ever since. These days, Sebastian prefers to let his music, the soundtrack for the play, do the talking.
Like I always am, like I don't usually talk much on things that, I don't know, I usually am I'm a quiet guy and I mostly play more than I talk, in the play.
Above all, he says, from the experience of being thrown together in this piece of theater, a firm friendship has grown, despite the actors' contrasting, even antagonistic backgrounds. Co-director Claudia Tangoa says the actors only knew each other's first names when rehearsals began.
Después de mucho tiempo de haber estado compartiendo un espacio, recién saber un poco la historia de la persona, pero lo importante ha sido conocerlos en el presente y a través de eso hacer una relación de trabajo, de amistad respecto a la persona que es en ese momento y en ese lugar.
Y no es que sea un grupo pues paz y amor, para nada. Hay conflictos todo el tiempo, nos peleamos todo el tiempo, hay discusiones todo el tiempo, como en cualquier grupo humano, creo. Pero esos conflictos, esas fricciones que hay entre nosotros son producto de lo que pasa aquí, no producto de la historia que tiene el otro, ¿no?
Peru is still deeply divided over what happened in its recent past. Could this piece of theater be an act of national reconciliation?
I don't know that it had helped to heal, but I think it will start a process in a lot of persons, in a lot of people, starting for all of us, starting for me not being so close-minded, right? I have to do this, and this is right, and you are wrong, you're bad. And that happens to all of us. We connected, we stop watching and giving so much credit to our prejudice, right? And we are starting to see our history and the history of our city or of our country in a different way.
La reconciliación es posible en la medida de que pasa por la verdad y la justicia, por esa aceptación de la historia del otro, de que no hay un solo lado de la historia, no solo fue un ángulo, fueron muchos, y todos esos ángulos posibles construyen la historia común de un pueblo.
The directors, however, shy away from giving the play such a grand design.
La obra sea un acto total de reconciliación, y no lo es, porque no, nosotros no, no es que siempre hemos querido buscar.
Claro. Tal vez algunos han esperado nosotros una actitud de activistas, y nosotros tenemos una postura, pero más que activistas somos artistas, ¿no? y estamos prevaleciendo lo humano de cada una de las personas que está aquí. Entonces, claro, siempre van a faltar puntos de vista para una historia. Nosotros tratamos de tener muchos puntos de vista para una historia, pero en un país tan fragmentado como el nuestro siempre van a faltar otros puntos de vista, ¿no? Pero sí, como dice Claudia, la mayoría de las personas que han visto el trabajo salen con una sensación de gratitud, ¿no? Y eso es para nosotros muy reconfortante.
Gratitude, perhaps, for the fact that Proyecto 1980-2000 has opened eyes, minds, and hearts by revisiting Peru's painful past in an honest way, in a production that is truly an example of art imitating life.
That was Dan Collins reporting from Peru. In 2003, a Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Peru attempted to take stock of the massacres, forced disappearances, and human rights violations during the country's internal conflict. As Dan Collins' story points out, however, even today there's still much to be reconciled, especially for those who grew up in those two turbulent decades. That brings us to the conclusion of our broadcast this week. You can find us on the web at cctv-america.com, and you can also find us on Facebook at cctvamerica.com. Please join us again next week for another edition of America's Now. See you then.